another formidable video. Today we're going to be making homemade masks. It's quick and it's easy to make. And since we're allowed to venture out our four walls, this will be protecting you. Enjoy the video. So when we begin, our masks have to be three layers thick. So on the outer layer, we've got some polycotton or cotton, or you can use t-shirts and material. For the inner layer, we've got some interfacing or muslin, but just remember your materials must be breathable. So step two, we're going to take our pattern and fold it in half. Then we're going to place it on the folded material. It's also in half, and then we'll be cutting it with these special scissors so it doesn't fray. And then you'll cut another one. And then you cut your muslin, the inner layer. And now we've got our pieces, so there's the two parts there. And the one here that we'll cut in half. So we have pinned our muslin inner layer on our outer layer, and then it should look like this. So once you've sewn the edges together, you will take the elastic band and then you thread it through the material, then you halve it like so. And then you pin the sides together once again, and then you sew these three edges closed and leave this middle edge flapped open. So once you've sewn both halves, you pin the two front pieces together. And then you sew them. So once you've sewn the front part together, you pin the back part, the back side, and then you're going to sew it as well. And there you have completed your mask. I hope you have liked this video. And make your mask. Be safe. Like this video. And subscribe right here. So we're just collecting the basil for our basil pesto. Make olive pesto. We've got basil, we've got olive oil, we've got black pepper, garlic, we've got salt, we've got cheese, and we've got thyme nuts. So first we're going to be cutting up the basil. The leaves of the stem. We're going to make 2 cups full of basil leaves to make the pesto. I'm just finishing putting the second cup of basil in the to put into the NutriBullet, and then we'll be adding the cheese. So we've got our basil. So we'll be adding then 1/2 cup of the cheese. So we're just going to then put 1/2 cup of the cheese. With the basil. Don't start yet. For a cup of nuts, it's also going in. And we're gonna add 1 tablespoon of garlic in. And then there's some salt, a pinch of salt, and some pepper. This will taste. Pulse all the hard materials. Then we've got the pesto. Then we're just going to add the olive oil in as well. Stop. And there's the basil pesto. So we're just going to fill the bottles with the pesto. So that's how much we got. Please subscribe to this video. And thank you. have some interesting coronavirus projects going on here. And we're going to, this video, we're going to show you what is going on.
Okay, so here's my redheaded brother over here, Ruben, and I'm Daniel. And so we're the big guys in the house now. And we've got some, yeah, like I said, some lockdown projects here in our garden that we'll like to show you and get our new YouTube channel started.
So there we've got some spinach going. We'll really like to get that patch going now in this time of lockdown where we can't really go anywhere. I mean, like, come on. And then we've got a blueberry bed over there, about 5 blueberries. Yeah, we've got that project for a while. And then behind there, got some strawberries. They've been really, really successful thanks to Ruben. It's his big project. And then a little lower down, then we have another strawberry box. We have another vegetable box. And yeah, that one needs some work, so we'll be doing that in the next while. And then right here by our feet, we've got our new dam that we are working on, our pond. That, yeah, you can see it's under construction. It's got a way to go, but we've got lots of time left, so hopefully we'll finish that before lockdown ends. And then scrolling down there, you can see the farm in the background, but right here in the garden we've got a couple of peach and apple and olive trees, some figs, but otherwise the olives have been the most successful, and we'd really like to up it a little bit this year. And here at the bottom of the garden, zooming there, that was our first, that's been our first lockdown project, and I think it was a great success. We've got 10 tilapia in here. We've rounded it off a bit. Maybe we can redo the pipe system, but I think we've rounded it off pretty nicely. The water does look bad right now, but like you can see in the sky, it's been a bit rainy. First big rains of 2020 in the Western Cape, and hopefully there'll be a lot more.
This is our strawberry project. We've got the strawberries here. We covered them in mulch to keep the water in and the weeds out, and we built this. It's quite an easy thing to build. You can do it at home if you want to, and we're going to hopefully get a few strawberries this summer. And we hope for the best.
Okay guys, that's all for today, and hopefully we'll come up with some other cool ideas to show you guys in this time of lockdown. And I hope you guys stay safe, stay at home, and enjoy it.
And that is for today. Please smash that subscribe button, click the thumbs up, and smash the notifications button if you want more videos. Thank you.
Yo, guys, come look here.
Okay guys, so today we're gonna collect a couple tilapia to put into our aquaponic system. We're gonna top it up a little bit, so we're gonna try our luck this afternoon and see how it goes.
Yo, guys, come look here.
What? Just leave it on the video. Keep it.
So this was enormously
fingerlings.
Brilliant. So we're gonna.
Oh. Oops, careful.
Is it tilapia? Yeah. So here's tons of banded tilapia. Probably like 20 odd in one cast. So now we quickly gonna take these and go and put them in our aquaponics. Last one.
Okay, so you guys saw that was an amazing cast. Now we're gonna put them back and count how many we got. So number one is 3, 4,
9, number 10, 12, 13, 14, 5 more at 19, number 20, whoa, come on, look at that. 21. 22. Number 23. One cast. Nice. Successful day at the office. Hey there, this is another Farm It All video. Today I am going to be experimenting a new planting method. I will be using coconut husk to plant my seeds. The researchers estimate that replacing synthetic polyester fibers with coconut husk fibers known as core will reduce petroleum consumption by 2 to 4 million barrels and carbon dioxide emission by 450 tons annually, according to physics.org. Core, or coconut fibers, is a natural fiber extracted from the outer husk of a coconut and is used in products such as floor mats, doormats, brushes, and mattresses. It is found in the outer layer of a coconut. Coconut husk acts as a good medium to grow plants. Coconut husk absorbs more water, thus keeping the medium wet always. The plant can grow by applying necessary nutrients to coconut husk. Since plants are not grown on soil, the coconuts will be free from soil-borne pests. So here we've got our coconut husk that we're just going to add about 40 mils of water to. And then hopefully the coconut husk will then absorb the water and thus will expand in so we could plant our seeds. So let's see what happens when we add the water. Okay, so now it's starting to grow bigger. You can see the water is getting pulled closer to the husk. And then it's expanding a lot, and it's very quick. Sure, it's shooting straight up. So now it's like just growing much. It's growing very big now. You can see it moves more upwards. It was growing at a funny angle. Just how it's absorbing all the water. Sorry about that. There you go. See that? That's only a few minutes, and now look how big it is. Sure. So this is our first one. Oh no, it breaks very easy. Just move the side there, and we've got another two that we can experiment with. Let me just put the one at the back there. So, and just suck up that water that's left, and yeah, it doesn't look like it's really absorbing like that. Okay, so now let's see how fast this one grows, or rises, whatever you want to say it. Look at that. So now we're just probably going to let him grow to his full height as well. And then we could probably start planting our seeds. After these two are probably will be enough to plant this our seeds in. Just add some more water there. There's nothing left. Just look how it grows. Just add some more water and then this goes much bigger, much quicker. Wow. This is the star. This is definitely the way to grow your pot plants in. So now here we just have a comparison between how it looked like, look how small that is, and now just look at that. It's like grown 4 times its size. Just amazing. And now that's just perfect things to plant seeds in. And yeah, just look at that. That's probably about 4 times the size of how it was. And now let's get our pot plants and plant our seeds. Got a cardboard pot that can decompose into the soil. We planted in and just patting that the coconut husk firmly into the pot, whatever you call it. And it's just moisture, it's wet, and that's beautiful. Just pat it in there. Now I've got 2 of those. Just let's get our seeds and plant. Okay, now just making the holes for the seeds so you can plant them in. Just twisting around there. Nicely done. And the seeds are ready to get in. So here we just put in a few seeds, about 3, 4. Maybe 5 seeds in each, in the coconut husk. Just putting them in there in the holes. There, you see them? And just close them. Oh, that's just so nice. There you go. And that's how you do it. So then hopefully your seeds will look like this after a few days. About a week or so. They'll germinate. And by about 40 days, they'll be nice. Guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. And I hope you guys try this at home. And let's try and get to 100 subscribers. And thank you for your support, guys. We just need 8 more to go. 92 probably when I post this video. And cheers. Welcome back to another Farm It's All video. Today we're going to be preparing our olives. And Don will be showing us how. And don't forget to subscribe.
Okay, so guys, today we're going to tell you guys about olives and how we make our brine. Obviously, there's many different ways of doing it, but we're going to show you how we like to do ours. So here's a look at the olives. They're not the best. They're the end of the season olives. Your mid-season would be about mid-March to end of March. So this is a bit like end of April kind of stuff. So you just put it in a sterilized jar. Just please remember to sterilize it. And if you don't have any jars, you can go buy some jars. Or just buy some jam and eat the jam and use the jar. So once you fill that up, you'll never really know how much boiled water you're going to need. So we just boiled 300 ml of water over there for today. We're probably not going to use all of it. And then some salt. And there's also a step 2 which we'll be showing you in 2 weeks time once these olives are ready, and that is where you start to flavor your olives with. Today's just keep putting them in a brine. Okay, so now all the olives are in And now you want to measure out the salt in a ratio of half a cup to 2 liters of water, because that's the general amount you use when you've got a lot of olives, which we don't have today. So here's a quarter cup measurer, and we've got about a quarter of a liter over there, so we just want half of this. So that's about half full, and then you put it in the water, and then you just wait for it while it mixes with the water, and then we'll just pour it into the olives. Okay, so the salt and the water is ready, so now we're just gonna pour it into the olives. You want it right to the brim. So there, it's totally full, and then you just screw the cap on, and then you want to store it in some other cupboard at room temperature, out of the sun, and then keep it there for 2 weeks, and then in 2 weeks' time we'll show you guys the next step, and we can carry on with the process.
Welcome back to another Farmer Talk video. Today we're going to be showing you about strawberries. And before we get on, please like and subscribe. And if you've enjoyed our other videos, please leave a thumbs up to this one and go and watch them. We'll leave a link in the description. And please watch this video to the end and enjoy it. Let us begin with the question, what is strawberries? A strawberry is a short plant in the wild strawberry genus of the rose family. The name is also used for its very common sweet edible fruit and for flavors that taste like it. The plant grown today is a mix of two other species of wild strawberries and was first grown in the 1750s. Now the question is, how are strawberries grown? So here I'm going to show you, this is the runner. So from the mother plant, a runner grows, and then it will form at the end of it another strawberry plant, and then it forms roots, and so it goes on and on. And that is how strawberries are grown. If you're going to buy strawberries, you'll buy them in such packages at the nurseries or other places. They'll be in black packages normally, and there'll be a single plant. So then most big strawberry farms grow their strawberries like this. It's easy to pick the strawberries since they're hanging down, and it is good advice to plant them like this. So we also did, if you look in the first videos, we plant ours like this as well, so it's much easier. Like what we did here, we put mulch, so it's like hay. It's so the soil keeps moist, and then the strawberries grow better. For example, on the top layer of ours, we don't have mulch, so look how dry the soil is. It's just crumbling in my hands, and the strawberries don't grow so well. So you can see they're getting brown, and we'll have to put mulch in there as well now. So now I will just put the drippers on, so it supplies our water. You can see the water falling there. Down there you can see the water falling. So I put it on, and I'm going to show you now on the top, where there's no mulch, just dry soil. It's the soil's the light color, and not all the places are wet. Yeah, and then at the bottom where there's mulch, the soil is much darker and it's soaking. That's the type of soil you want strawberries to grow in. Then there's the drippers running. they're running. So that what you'll obviously use if you have bigger, like a strawberry farm, and if you want to make one, you get drippers and a dripper system. And yeah, that's, it works well, and that's how we grow our strawberries. Now we move on to harvesting. So when the harvesting season in the United States will be April, May and June, and in South Africa will be October and November, so it's around the springtime. And your average harvest per plant will be 150 to 400 grams, but that'll be after 2 harvesting years. That'll be your average. Strawberries is a very fragile berry, but if you just take care of it well and feed it, it will be easier and there will be a big reward at the end. If you have lots of strawberries, you'll get a pleasant harvest, and like ours, here's a photo. You can make lots of dishes with strawberries and they are very nice. And guys, that'll be the video. If you like this video, please leave a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't yet. And thank for the people who have subscribed and supported us. And if you've got any ideas, leave it in the comments. And that'll be this video. Thank you very much.
Hi guys, today we're going to be talking about this billionaire born in Pretoria, South Africa. Elon Musk is to make history today or either tomorrow, depending on the weather, with the SpaceX launch of humans to the ISS. The first time a private company will be sending people to space. Now obviously this is not his main goal. His goal is to colonize Mars. But these are the steps that he's taking to get there. So, ranked as the 31st richest person on the Forbes list with $36.7 billion, most coming from Tesla and SpaceX near that, and then some other companies. There's 6 different industries with which he wants to transform the future of humankind. SpaceX is one company that has been making the headlines a lot this week. On Wednesday, they were set to make their historic launch of human beings to the ISS space station. Unfortunately, the weather aborted the mission, but hopefully today or either tomorrow, they'll be successful in their task, because this is fundamental to Elon Musk's success in going to Mars. Here are 2 of SpaceX's most used rockets, the Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy. The Falcon 9 will be used to take 2 astronauts up to space. This rocket alone has done 84 launches, which makes it the workhorse of America. But neither of these 2 rockets are set to make Mars. For that, Elon Musk would really like to get his Starship on the go, which has been undergoing many tests recently, which have been making progress. Now, the Dragon capsule is by far the most technologically advanced capsule that's ever gone to space, thanks to SpaceX and Tesla's innovation in lots of software and such things that have helped them combine that into this capsule, so that the 2 astronauts will have a great, wonderful, comfortable trip without any buttons or any difficulties. So this is how Elon Musk plans to take people to space for now. Tesla. Now, Tesla's been booming. Yesterday, they did about 4% up after cutting the prices of some of their vehicles due to the fact that they can now make batteries cheaper with their acquisitions and all. And they also have many other products on the line.
They are now currently the second most valuable car manufacturer in the world, but like I said, they do many things, including energy and solar panels, batteries. Now, this is a range of Tesla's cars. Most of them haven't gone into full manufacturing, but still, it's quite a sexy lot, if you get what I mean. So, I don't know who thought it up. It probably was Elon, but it's pretty cool. So, first you've got the Model S, which was their first big hit because the Roadster wasn't as successful as anybody thought it would be. And then the Model 3, X, Y, and then the Semi and the Cybertruck. Now, how do solar tiles work? Yes, I know, you've probably never heard of them. These are solar panels built into tiles so that the solar panels don't ruin the look of your roof. And Tesla is the only person with something like this on the market. But it's still under lots of development and changes lately. So this is what they call Tesla's battery farm in South Australia, which has been giving electricity to many homes there in blackouts and such things. And Tesla is the only manufacturer of batteries that can do it at this kind of a scale, at that kind of a price tag. So in terms of commercial battery use, Tesla's the number one leading company in those kind of things. And then Elon Musk has also been working on The Boring Company. This is a company that makes tunnels that are much, much, much narrower than your usual tunnels, much safer, you can travel much faster, and like he says, we live in a 3D world and our roads are 2D, so this is his three-dimensional roads, and he claims you can put about four or five tunnels on top of each other, which would relieve the traffic in many cities quite a lot. And then on the AI side of things, he's been working a lot with his company Neuralink and OpenAI, which both work so that humans will survive when AI becomes a thing, because he feels we'll be endangered by robots with more intelligence than us. So Neuralink mainly focuses on attaching our brains to, like say, a computer, so that we can just download information. But there's many other things that Elon Musk's been doing over the last couple of years.
Welcome to Bible Verses for your week. So let's get into this with our first verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1, verse 1. So this is quite a simple verse. It's short. But also what I love of this verse, it's just not my favorite verse. It just explains so much. It's just explaining God created the heavens and the earth. There's no big deal that scientists have. It's simple, straightforward. The first verse in the Bible, God created the heavens and the earth. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Joshua 1 verse 9. So the Lord is telling us, do not be afraid, discouraged, or ashamed for who we are, but the Lord God is with us wherever we go, and we don't have to panic or worry because He is with us. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but those who delight in the law of the Lord and who meditates on His law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by a stream of water which yields its fruit in season, and those leaves does not wither. Whatever they do prosper. Psalms 1 verse 1 to 3. So here we learn that we must not become part of the world, but we must actually live in the world, but be separated from it. We must live and be obedient to the word of the Lord and be like a tree that is, has fruit in every season and grow. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. Mark 1:17. Jesus is meaning here that we must evangelize and spread the word of God to the people out in the world, and that we're not really fishing for people, but fishing for their souls, and that they may also evangelize and so spread on the word of God, and that we may collect the people like fish, and then God will sort them out and keep the good ones and throw away the bad. Call to me and I will answer you, and I will tell you great and unhidden things that you have not known. Jeremiah 33 verse 3. So if we call to God, he will answer our requests and prayers, because he's the God of all knowing and all power and all majesty. We don't have to feel afraid or shy to ask him, because he loves us and that he will answer us and tell us great things. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him. Stand firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. 1 Peter 5 verse 8 to 9. As a Christian on earth, you must just keep in mind that the devil is always going to try and destroy your life and try and get you to move away from God and his and your love for him. So you must always be aware and of things that's going on around you, and also that you must keep in contact with many people that serve the Lord. And that's really much what we learn out of this verse. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly light. James 1 verse 17. So every perfect gift that we receive or talent is from God, that he wants us to use for his glory and as a witness or a testimony to tell other people. And we must just keep in mind all those things and praise him for that. So that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God. Colossians 1 verse 10. God has given us talents that we must use to inspire people and to show people the way to God, and that we may stand like a lighthouse in the world that's so dark, and that we may shine. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greater commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Matthew 22 verse 34 to 40. So now Jesus is breaking down the previous 10 commandments that he gave to Moses, and then summarizing those 10 into these two commandments that's all about love. Be doers of the word. James 1 verse 22. So this means you must not just go to church, sit there, listen to the pastor, and then go home. You must take an action of the word that you hear and you or you read. And you must go and you must pray for people. You must talk to your friends that don't know about Jesus, and then you must try and tell them a bit and spread the word of God. But to all who did receive him, he gave the right to become children of God. John 1 verse 12. So if you receive that God died on the cross for you and rose again on the third day, then he gives you the right to become his children, and he will love you and receive you who you are, and he created you, and he will take care of your needs, and he will love you with all his heart. When the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go, then they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. When Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth is given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you to the very end of the age." Matthew 28:16-20. Guys, just here, Jesus has commanded us to go to all the nations and to tell the people about his love for us and what he wants them to do for his kingdom, and that they must receive him and be baptized and be born again. I tell you, no, but unless you repent, you too will all perish. Luke 13 verse 3. So this sounds a bit hard, but like I said just earlier, we must repent and turn. We have to take off this baggage that is holding us back, the sin. We must put it down before Jesus and we must leave it. We must not carry on with this thing, otherwise we will be living an eternal hell. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that stays in me and I in him shall bring forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. John 15 verse 5. So we must think that Jesus is the stem of our life and we the branches, and we must grow fruit that bear and prosper. That it's just like evangelizing and going out like I've been saying all this time. That everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. John 3 verse 15 to 17. Here it speaks just again about God's love for us. God loves you and he cares for you. No matter how you look, who you are, and we must just remember that we serve him and he is God of all. He loves us because he created us, he formed us, and he has a purpose for you and me in the world that we may bring him honor and glory. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Have a great week. God bless.
Making money while you sleep. Now doesn't that sound fantastic? Well, guess what? You can, through passive income. Today I'm going to share with you a couple of ways that you can passively earn cash and why it's so much better than earned income. The reason why it's so much better than earned income is you don't necessarily trade time for money, and that is very valuable. Passive income is maybe not for everybody, but if you have skill, patience, and time, writing a book is probably just what you need to do. J.K. Rowling earned $92 million off her Harry Potter series. You never know, maybe you also achieve the same. But the whole thing with writing a book is, yes, it will take you quite a bit of time to write it, but once it's in the publisher's hands and the public enjoy it, the money will start rolling into your pocket. Starting a YouTube channel is the only thing that stuff like us maniacs can think of. But all you need is a cell phone. On there you can film, edit, audio, everything you need to get your channel up and running and keep it going. Yes, you will have to work on it maybe on a weekly, maybe even daily basis. But once your videos are out there, people will over time keep watching them and the money will keep rolling in. Yes, it's not for everybody. You will need to know a thing or two about software. But today, I'm just going to share with you how app builders earn a passive income. The first way they do it is in-app purchases, where you need to purchase your upgrades on the app, or when they update the app and they put a price on the update. If you enjoy the app, you'll buy the update, and that's how they earn their cash. Patents, the first thing you need is a great idea. Now, there is no reason in the world why you can't be the one with the next great idea. The next step is making it a reality. And then you go to the registration and you go and register your patent. Then whoever wants to use your idea will either not be allowed to, or they'll have to pay you or pay the patent from you. And in that way, you could earn a smart amount of cash. Yes, I know, taking half an hour out of your day to write a little story about your day, your opinion on something, or what's been happening in your life, just doesn't sound very appealing. But it might even pay you more than your 9-to-5 job, and it'll take you much less time. But it's definitely one of the harder ways to earn this income, because you'll need a lot of people keeping up with your blogging. If you know you have tons of wacky and wonderful photos that the world wants to see, why don't you go and license them? Put them on the internet, and whoever wants to get that photo needs to pay you. That is a brilliant way to promote your photography skills and also to earn income, maybe through a hobby or a lucky shot. You never know. I know, lending your money out to other people's already just got a bad feel towards it. That's why maybe don't do it with friends or family. Just have the right paperwork, somebody you don't necessarily know all that well, but somebody that you do trust, and then try and put compound interest or higher interest rates on it. And then instead of just letting your cash lie in the bank, you can get it back later on for much more than what it was originally worth. Affiliate marketing is a wonderful thing to do once you have tons of followers and subscribers on social media platforms. This is when you get a brand to promote and you promote them, and on everything they sell from through your site or your recommendation, you get a small commission for, or they might just pay you monthly for recommending their products. But like I said, you'll need a huge follower and subscription base. Starting a business is definitely one of the toughest but most rewarding things you can do in your life. Yes, in the beginning it's going to take tons of time and energy and frustration and stress to get it all going. But if you've got a great business idea, you've done your research, you've got a business plan, and along the way you develop some skills, in the end everything should hopefully come right. But again, in the business world, you never ever know. Rental income is for people who have high earned income salaries and who really want to get that passive income portfolio going. Then just get income coming off your real estate, because the moment that your real estate becomes an asset instead of a liability, then the rest of all your expenses and incomes just look a lot better at the end of the day. And you can go on that wonderful holiday or that great retirement you've always dreamed. Be a very sophisticated form of passive income, and that is why we have another video pending for you guys, just to broaden your view on the stock market. So with the stock market, it's a great place to put your money away and hope and pray for it to grow. But also, if you've made wise to research decisions, you shouldn't stress about it. What you're really looking for in the stock market is that one company that you believe over the next few years will grow, and with that your fortune will grow too. You fly. When your dreams come alive, you're unstoppable. Take a shot, chase the sun, find the beautiful. We will go in the dark, turning dust to gold, and we'll dream impossible.